That little chip in your computer, yeah, it's complex, but it manages that complexity in an incredibly elegant way. Today, we explore just one aspect of how it does that. I think even among those of us who aren't particularly tech savvy, we would probably have heard of the CPU, the central processing unit in your computer. We probably have some impression that it takes in data, does some calculation and stuff, and that's where the magic happens. While that's a fairly good start to understanding the CPU, I think we can afford to delve a little further today to better see how tasks are being managed by the CPU, as well as to consider how it interacts with the rest of the hardware in your computer. Today, we'll speak in very general terms, not focusing on any specific CPU architecture. Instead, I just want to focus on one specific optimization technique that I find interesting. As we go through today's concepts, you may find that you are already familiar with some of them. Good for you! Feel free to skip ahead by using the links in the video description or by using the chapters on the seatbelt. Let's start with CPU basics. We know that your computer runs programs. At a lower level, these programs are essentially instructions, simple steps expressed in the language of hardware for your CPU to understand and execute. Here's the interesting thing. Most instructions aren't done instantly. Each step can be broken down further into subtasks that are common to the processing of many of the instructions. One basic five-step model to explain this is fetch, decode, read, execute, write back. While you find a step to execute any instruction, some combination of these five subtasks must happen. Here's what they mean. Fetching involves pulling the actual instruction out of RAM, that is, the random access memory of your computer. Yeah, instructions don't just fall into your lap for free. The CPU must fetch them. Then, the decode step is where your CPU tries to understand the instruction. Typically, instructions are just big numbers. If you break it down into its binary representation, different sets of bits represent different things. For example, the number represented by the first couple of bits could be the opcode, that is, the number representing the operation to be done. It could be arithmetic, like addition, logic, like comparing two numbers, or even reads and writes to RAM. The rest of the numbers are the operands to that operation. The decode step is pretty much mandatory to understand exactly what your CPU is supposed to do. The read step involves fetching the required operands in which the operation is meant to act on. For example, if you have an addition operation between two numbers held in two registers, that is, little banks of memory that live directly on the CPU, this is where we visit the two registers to retrieve those values. Now that we know what we want to do, and we have the required information to operate on, we can proceed to the execution step. That is when the operation is actually done. So whatever calculation or comparison takes place, and the result is ready for the next step. Finally, there is writeback, in which the result is stored somewhere. This could be back into the registers or even to RAM. It wouldn't be amiss to imagine these subtasks to be different stages on a pipeline, and every instruction needs to go through all of these stages to be executed to completion. So this breakdown, this abstraction, is a great way to think about exactly what a CPU does. However, in doing this, we also start to see an interesting flaw. While yes, an instruction must go through every pipeline stage, let's shift our attention to the other stages as an instruction is moving through the pipeline. Notice that more often than not, the other pipeline stages are idle. While an instruction is being executed, the fetch, decode, read, and write back stages are just sitting there. As you can imagine, it will be horrible for performance if, at any given point in time, only a fifth of your CPU is really doing anything. We're not making good use of resources this way. But here's the good news. We can do what is known as instruction-level parallelism, which is fancy speak for saying that we don't really have to wait for one instruction to finish up before starting on the next one. You see, the beauty of this pipeline is that the stages are independent of each other. For the most part, in fact, we'll get in trouble for this, but let's save that for later. Assuming then that the steps are completely independent of each other, we can absolutely send in a second instruction while the first one is still being worked on. What this means is at any given moment, if you were to look at the pipeline, you will see that every single stage is hard at work. But the beauty of this is that each stage is working on a completely different instruction. every instruction still needs to move through the entirety of the pipeline, of course. But by not waiting and moving straight on to the next instruction, we eliminate idle time. Alright, where's the catch? In an ideal world, this would just work. But unfortunately, certain combinations of instructions back-to-back could create some unexpected problems. We call these hazards. Let's say we have these two instructions one after another, and I'm going to use simplified instructions here to make things easier. Imagine W, X, Y, and Z to be some registers on the processor. Intuitively, what we'd expect to happen is Y and Z are added together and stored in X. Then we make a copy of X into W. However, if these two statements were run one immediately after the other in a pipeline, what would happen? Let's find out. Assuming we're still sticking to the 5-stage pipeline described previously, here's what's going to happen. If the first instruction starts at T equals 0, it's going to do its magic and write the answer into register X by T equals 5. Now, consider the second instruction, which needs to read off the value of X. It has to do this by T equals 3. That's where its read stage is. We should be done with the entire calculation by T equals 5. But the value of X is only available at T equals 5. I don't know what the second instruction is reading off, but it's not going to be correct, simply because the correct answer isn't yet ready. The formal name for this is a read after write hazard, because that's exactly what happened. We're reading immediately after writing, and we're not ready for that. So, how do we deal with this problem? There are several strategies that are relevant here, the simplest of which is a pipeline stall. We simply wait. If we know that information isn't going to be populated in time, we simply pause the second instruction. It will sit around and wait until the data is ready, then it continues. Well, very simple to discuss and implement, the drawback of course is that we now have these bubbles in a pipeline. The whole reason why we want to do pipelining is to avoid idle moments, and adding a stall sort of flies in the face of that. Of course, the hope is that hazards don't crop up often, so this will still, statistically at least, be better than no pipelining at all. Of course, more sophisticated strategies can be employed here. One such solution is operand forwarding. Think of this as a secret passage that connects different pipeline stages together. Information can take that shortcut and jump to a later stage ahead of time. Let's try the same example using the same pipelining model as before, but now, imagine there is some means of communication going from the execute stage back to the read stage. The second instruction still needs a stall at T equals 3. You can't avoid that since the answer hasn't been calculated yet. However, we can avoid waiting for the callback if we simply send that answer along that secret passage to the read stage at the very moment in which it's ready. Thanks to this, we only need to stall for one unit of time, and the two operations now finish at T equals 7 instead. Alright, let's throw another instruction into the mix. Let's say now, our instructions look like this. Here's what would happen if we executed them faithfully, step by step. Because of the stall in executing the second instruction, the third one couldn't simply power its way through, so it needs to stall as well. Thus, you can imagine how a stall creates this cascading effect, until that bubble disappears entirely from the system. But here's the thing, do we really need to do that? If you take a closer look at the third instruction, you'll find that it's completely independent of the two preceding instructions, in that it doesn't rely on W, X, Y, or Z. This is important because if an instruction is completely independent like this, we don't actually have to run it in order. Try this, let's swap the order of the second and third statements and see where this gets us. Since the new second instruction doesn't really care about the first, we can push it into the pipeline and let it run to completion by T equals 6. Now, the third instruction kicks in at T equals 2, with its read stage slated to kick in at T equals 4. Let's say our operator forwarding is still active, so the result of the execution of the first instruction at T equals 3 gets pushed directly to the read stage of the third instruction. No stall required, it just picks up and carries on, finishing all three instructions in 7 cycles. That's right, by just executing the instructions out of order, we eliminate even the last stall, making full use of our CPU with no idling at all. Of course, as you can imagine, putting instructions out of order is a delicate thing to do. We have a very contrived example here, but in reality, variables and lines of code affect each other in complex ways that mean we may not be able to reliably reverse their order without creating weird problems down the line. CPUs must be smart at determining whether statements are dependent or not before carrying out such an optimization. So far, we've considered sequential instructions, and that's already a can of worms sometimes. But get ready to open an even bigger one when we introduce branching. If statements and loops both cause your code to jump from one instruction to another, and oftentimes, this jump is based on a condition. Let's start by seeing what that looks like in the pipeline before taking a closer look at the conundrum it creates. Take for example, a simple conditional jump, say at the end of a countdown loop, in which we'll jump back to the start of the loop if the loop counter is still greater than zero. A typical instruction used in this context will be along the lines of branch if not zero. Its parameter would be whatever register the loop counter lives in. What does that look like in the pipeline then? We need to fetch and decode this instruction to know that we want to do a conditional jump. We then need to read off the parameter, then execute the comparison before we can actually conclude whether we should jump away or simply fall through and continue on. That's not too bad, but what about the rest of the pipeline? In the four cycles it takes to decide whether or not to jump away, we've still got to load things into the pipeline. But the question is, where from? If we're jumping away, we should start loading the pipeline with instructions from the destination of the jump. Conversely, if we're staying put, we should just load up these subsequent instructions. But the thing is, we don't know, do we? We can only guess at whether the branch is supposed to be taken or not. If we guess wrongly, we end up loading up a set of instructions that were never meant to be executed, before we realize we're wrong. At that point, we've got to throw everything out in what is known as a pipeline flush. This of course sets us way back, much worse than a stall does, since we are starting from a clean slate and have to load up instructions from scratch. So the thing is, we also have to be kinda smart about how we predict whether a branch is taken or not. In a previous example, if we know that a branch is used in a loop, then it probably makes more sense to just assume it's taken. We'll be wrong once at the time in which the loop exits, but that's the safer option because the alternative, which is to assume the jump isn't taken, is going to be wrong for every iteration of the loop except the last one. The thought process here is what is called branch prediction, and it turns out that there are many strategies out there for doing this. These processes are generally what's known as heuristics, which is a fancy word for saying, we're just guessing. Of course, the better the heuristic, the more likely it'll be correct. At its simplest, static branch prediction is used. These just look at individual instructions as they come along and apply some rule-based strategy to guess at whether the branch is taken. For example, the CPU can decide that all backward branches are not taken and all forward branches are taken. Of course, this has to match the way in which the programs are written for best results. CPUs can also use random branch prediction, leaving things to a game of chance. By randomly deciding whether or not branches are taken, it aims for the perfect middle ground of 50%. Then there is dynamic branch prediction, which is the most interesting of all, since it employs some strategies to learn over time. By recording whether or not past branches are taken, it can use that track record to factor in whether or not the next branch is likely to be taken. Such strategies can get complicated, utilizing additional memory, perhaps having a table somewhere, or even loading up multiple instructions in blocks to analyze them. Some CPUs employ multiple sets of branch predictors, perhaps tuned with different priorities, say one to be quicker and the other to be slower but more accurate, and the two have to duke it out. And of course, in this age of AI, some CPUs are even using neural network-based methods. And that's it! Today we looked at a simple model of a CPU pipeline to see how it helps us with parallelism. We saw that while this can help keep every part of the CPU busy, the drawback is that weird things like hazards can happen. This gets worse when branching is involved because we are at risk of loading up the wrong thing and having to flush it all out. The amount of optimization that goes into designing a commercial product like a CPU is astounding. We've barely scraped the surface and, to be honest, we've glossed over all the nitty-gritty implementation details. but I hope this gives you a good idea of just how complex things can get. That's all there is for today's video. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, you're watching 0612 TV with NERDfirst.net. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this video and are feeling generous, a donation to this channel will be greatly appreciated. There's a link on screen and in the video description for more details. Meanwhile, please do like, comment, and subscribe. This helps the channel tremendously and gives me the means to do more. Thank you once again, and I'll see you next time.